Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Death Gap, How Inequality Kills, by David A. Ansell, M.D. Narrated by Peter Berkrot. Preface. One Street, Two Worlds. History will have to record that the greatest tragedy of this period of social transition was not the strident clamor of the bad people, but the appalling silence of the good people. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. He who passively accepts evil is as much involved in it as he who helps to perpetrate it. He who accepts evil without protesting against it is really cooperating with it. Martin Luther King, Jr. We all die, but tens of thousands of Americans die too early. These early deaths are not random events. These deaths strike particular individuals who live in particular American neighborhoods. And while we know that people die of cancer, heart disease, and so on, this killer isn't one that we can treat with drugs, therapy, or surgery. This killer is inequality. This is a book about inequality and its impact on longevity. Inequality triggers so many causes of premature death that we need to treat inequality as a disease and eradicate it, just as we would seek to halt any epidemic. This is bigger than a war on cancer. It requires reassessing who we are as a country and as a people. It requires that we take action against a host of offenses that rob people of their dignity and their lives. This sounds amorphous and abstract, but it is very concrete and specific. Inequality is all around us, as are the deaths it causes. We witness it along one Chicago street. Ogden Avenue, Chicago. A microcosm of American health inequity. Ogden Avenue cuts a diagonal swath across the crisscross monotony of Chicago's street grid. This major thoroughfare began as a Potawatomi trading path, the tract from Lake Michigan through 9 miles of mud, muck, and prairie to the Des Plaines riverbanks in the present-day town of Riverside. The Des Plaines pours into the Illinois River, which in turn flows into the Mississippi and on down to New Orleans and the Gulf of Mexico. White settlers planked the path over in the early 1800s as a defense against persistent, glue-like mud, and the city of Chicago paved it in the early 1900s. Ogden Avenue later became a critical Midwest link in the famous Route 66, a highway that connected the East and West coasts in the early 20th century. Although Ogden Avenue's glory days have faded, the neighborhood it traverses offer a lens into the impact of inequality. Ogden's four-lane asphalt, peppered with potholes, slices through an incredible diversity of neighborhoods, connecting wide, lawned western suburbs to the edge of the steel and glass-towered Gold Coast, and to some of the lowest-income, most economically distressed communities in the country. The marginalized residents of these communities don't just have different lifestyles, they have different lives. Most critically, people who live in those western suburbs and on the Gold Coast live significantly longer than the people in the struggling neighborhoods in between. A 20-minute commute exposes a near 20-year life expectancy gap. In my 3+ decades as a doctor who practiced along Ogden Avenue, I learned a simple truth. Where you live dictates when you die. This is not just true in Chicago. Every region in the United States has a street or highway like Ogden Avenue. Travel 3rd Avenue in New York, 30 blocks up from the Upper East Side to Harlem, and lose 10 years of life. Take a short cruise along the 405 in Los Angeles, and 16 years of life expectancy vanish. A drive along Ogden Avenue gives us a curbside view of high mortality neighborhoods. Before gentrification transformed it, One of those struggling communities off Ogden was called Skid Row. Block upon block of dollar-a-night transient hotels and converted warehouses housed single men and women within sight of the downtown steel and glass skyscrapers. These flophouses sported glamorous names. The Viceroy, Working Men's Palace, The Gem, but accommodated mainly alcoholics, junkies, prostitutes, and the mentally ill. In 1980, during my training as a doctor, a health worker and I made a house call to one of those hotels, in search of a patient with tuberculosis who had missed an appointment. We carried the life-saving antibiotics to dispense, if only we could find him. We scaled an unlit stairway that reeked of stale urine up to a dormitory consisting of wall-to-wall stalls, each 6 by 4 feet and crowned with chicken wire, dubbed bird cages. Only the faintest light filtered through dirt-speckled plate glass windows. We opened the unlocked door to our patient's birdcage and found only a metal army cot with a shabby mattress and a weathered wooden dresser. There was barely room to stand. Tuberculosis had killed the prior 3 occupants of this particular birdcage, and no wonder. It was a perfect environment for the disease to thrive, dark, damp, and suffocating, yet steps from the wealth of the Gold Coast. Skid Row was an epicenter for the tuberculosis and AIDS epidemics that ravaged the city in the 1980s, and the neighborhood mortality rate reflected this. In the 1990s, developers raised these flophouses to erect new apartments and loft buildings catering to young professionals and aging baby boomers moving in from the suburbs. Southwest on Ogden from the former Skid Row neighborhood is the vast West Side ghetto. It is no different from many other inner-city neighborhoods in America, with empty lots interspersed with graffiti-marked boarded-up businesses, the blinking red neon arrows of liquor marts, iron-barred currency exchanges, catfish joints, and storefront churches on crumbling sidewalks. There are no signs of that ancient prairie trail here, except the occasional black-eyed Susan that emerges in the late summer through sidewalk cracks. The mortality rate here is among the worst in the city and the nation. Just before Ogden enters the rundown neighborhoods of Chicago's West Side, it passes, in quick succession, the 3 hospitals where I have practiced internal medicine since I arrived in the Windy City in 1978. A public safety net hospital, John H. Stroger Jr. Hospital of Cook County, a private safety net hospital, Mount Sinai Hospital, and an academic hospital, Rush University Medical Center, my current home. My work as a doctor in these 3 Chicago hospitals has given me a unique vantage point on inequality and its connection to life and death. As you head southwest on Ogden, Rush appears on the east, a shiny white butterfly-shaped tower that seems to hover 14 stories above the street and is connected by bridges to an array of hospital and research buildings that splay westward. Despite its otherworldly look, Rush was the first medical school in Chicago, chartered in 1837, 2 days before the city itself was incorporated. Next, you see, kitty-corner to the western edge of Rush, the old Cook County Hospital. County, as the doctors called it, where generations of the uninsured and the down-and-out sought medical care. Old County, a squat, 2-block-long, 8-story behemoth, now sits abandoned, boarded up and bedraggled. An 8-foot-high chain-link fence surrounds County's main entrance to keep homeless squatters from seeking shelter underneath its faded blue canopy. Its ailing yellow brick-clad Beaux-Arts facade is adorned with 3-story pairs of fluted Ionic columns, multicolored terracotta cornices, sculpted faces of roaring lions and cherubs. Once an architectural gem, it is now covered in soot and held together by netting and stainless steel straps. When I was 26 years old, medical diploma in hand, I traded the lush green hills of upstate New York for the asphalt and steel of Chicago to work at this legendary training ground for generations of doctors and nurses. I intended to stay for just 3 years, but the human drama and misery I witnessed compelled me to remain longer. I practiced there for 17 years. In 2002, county was shuttered by hospital officials and replaced by the John H. Stroger Jr. Hospital, a chunky structure that sits right behind Old County and serves the same population of the poor, the unwanted, and those with no other medical options. Those two hospitals kitty-corner from each other expose the extremes of healthcare in America. A beautiful and expensive institution where the finest care is available, and another that has struggled at times to provide even the most basic care to poor people. My understanding of the contrasts between life and death in rich and poor patients have been deepened by my years at County and Rush. But another Ogden Avenue hospital provides a third perspective on how survival gaps have become ingrained into neighborhoods and the institutions that serve them. Continue another 0.8 mile down Ogden Avenue, and a railroad viaduct looms into view, spanning the roadway. Painted on it is a blue and white advertisement for the Sinai Health System, whose flagship institution soon appears on the left. Mount Sinai Hospital, where I worked from 1995 to 2005, is a mismatched mass of utilitarian brick and concrete buildings that crowd the corner of Ogden and California. A Jewish industrialist established Sinai in 1919 as a hospital for the Eastern European Jews who were surging into the industrial North Lawndale ghetto. During the 1950s, black migration from the Deep South transformed the community. As unscrupulous real estate agents inflamed racist fears of black people, whites fled in droves. Lawndale flipped from an all-white neighborhood of 87,000 to an all-black one of 125,000. Imagine what happens to a community's stability when 220,000 people, the equivalent of a medium-sized city, migrate in and out of it within a single decade. When Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. brought his civil rights fight north in 1966, he moved into Lawndale, just blocks from Sinai. In 1968, following King's assassination, some distraught community members torched neighborhood businesses in the anger and rebellion that racked the West Side for days. Most of the businesses that lined the Roosevelt Road shopping corridor near Sinai never reopened. And within a few years, the remaining industries that had provided reliable work and health insurance to Lawndale residents fled to the suburbs. Years of disinvestment and neglect followed. From my corner office on the 9th floor of Sinai, I could see two brick towers that loomed over Lawndale, one to the north and one directly west. To the north towered the Sears Roebuck Company headquarters and catalog factory, which employed tens of thousands of people until the 1970s, when it fled to the downtown high-rise that bore its name. To the west, the decaying Hawthorne Works Tower now lords over a working-class strip mall with a Foot Locker, a Dollar General, and an abandoned storefront clinic. The tower was once the headquarters of a giant Western Electric plant that manufactured electronics and phones, employing 25,000 people before it shuttered and stripped thousands of community members of jobs and health insurance. Jobs at the mall do not have the security or the pay that the old industrial jobs did. The flight of industry marked the beginning of Lawndale's spiral into misery and concentrated poverty. By the 1990s, Lawndale's population had dwindled to about 40,000. Median income sank beneath the Chicago average, and the rates of uninsured grew. As a result, Lawndale's life expectancy today is among the lowest in the Chicago region. Lawndale is one particular neighborhood, along one particular street, in one particular city. But the story of Lawndale is the story of rising inequality and premature death in America's abandoned neighborhoods. The flight of people, jobs, and wealth, and the impoverishment of neighborhoods that ensued triggered America's current inequality crisis. We can trace the growth of the uninsured population and the widening death and wealth gaps between rich and poor, between black and white, to events like those that transpired in Lawndale. But the root of America's inequality crisis is not just the flight of people, jobs, and wealth. The active exploitation of those without resources, by those controlling economic and political power in the United States, subverted the ability of neighborhood residents to fight back. This fact is critical to understanding why inequality is so entwined in the tapestry of American life and so difficult to eradicate. If we are ever to reverse course, we need to understand the active nature of this exploitation. It was not just a bad economy and prejudice that crippled Lawndale and neighborhoods like it across the United States. The abusive conditions that foster inequality are perpetuated by the actions of the powerful to enrich themselves at the expense of others. From the racially inflammatory blockbusting encouraged by corrupt local government and the real estate industry in the mid-20th century, through tax policies that have redistributed wealth from the poor and middle class to the wealthy, to the Machiavellian mass evictions, as well as the racist policing and incarceration practices of the 21st century, the persistence of inequality in American life is not the result of random events, bad choices, or bad luck, but rather the result of active acts of commission. Hardwired inequality. On one street, in one city, at three hospitals within 1 mile of one another, I discovered that inequality is hardwired into our healthcare delivery system and into the neighborhoods these hospitals serve. I learned from my practice along Ogden something that I was not taught in medical school. Inequality itself is a cause of death. But how was I supposed to treat it? What was it about the poverty and segregation of neighborhoods like Lawndale that led to high rates of common diseases, such as diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, and depression? I was trained to treat the biological and psychological manifestations of disease, not alter the characteristics of neighborhoods. This inequality is invisible to the thousands of commuters who whiz by every day. But as a doctor, I have witnessed the suffering that inequality has inflicted on my patients and the healthcare institutions that serve the poor. At Rush, the right insurance card provides access to world-class healthcare and just about any service imaginable. Modern biomedicine is booming at Rush as the therapeutic armamentarium grows. But if you have the wrong insurance card at Rush, or no insurance card, access to some doctors and services is blocked. At Stroger, a patient receives the best care the hospital has to offer without regard to ability to pay, but often after a mind-numbing wait. Some critical specialty services and even some basic care, such as screening mammograms and colonoscopies, are often unavailable in the county system. At Sinai, the conditions are similar to Stroger, but with better access to some specialists, yet not to all. For example, both Stroger and Sinai have busy trauma units, and the mostly poor minority patients dying there donate many of the organs used in transplantation at the wealthier transplant centers across the city. Yet in my 27 years at those institutions, not one of my patients, or those of my colleagues, ever received a life-saving organ transplant. At Sinai, chronic funding shortages meant that the facilities were dated and improvements always limited. While Sinai had dedicated itself to addressing the ills of the surrounding communities, it often lacked the finances to provide all the necessary care. While most financially stable not-for-profit hospitals have hundreds of days of cash reserves to support the delivery of services, during my days at Sinai, we were strapped for money. The lack of cash reserves limited investment in clinical services to only the most crucial, and this inevitably affected the quality of care. Year after year, replacement of the kidney dialysis machine at Sinai was put off for lack of funds. When the federal government began to require that dialysis units report the quality of their treatments, Sinai's patients performed worse than the national average, because without the right equipment, even the best doctors cannot always provide the best care. Ultimately, new machines were purchased and the quality improved. In my 17 years at County, not once did one of my patients who needed a joint replacement for debilitating arthritis get one. Even now, 30 years later, there is at least a 5-year waiting list for joint replacements at Stroger. In 10 years at Sinai, I had a number of patients with severely arthritic joints, but only 2 got them replaced. But at Rush, a mecca for orthopedics, you can get on the list for a joint replacement in a few weeks, provided you have the proper insurance card. The chief medical officer at the county health system once told me, "David, the waiting list for the eye clinic at county is so long that you can go blind on it." And yet across the street at Rush, a patient can get into the eye clinic with no delay. When I was on the front lines at county and Sinai, my patients were uninsured, black and Latino, and poor. In America, that means they were often excluded from accessing the very best in treatments. I treated many patients who suffered or died early because the life-saving treatments available just down the street were beyond their reach. I did the best I could for my patients. I rationalized that the care I was giving was good enough. But when I reached Rush and saw an institution awash in medical wealth, I knew I was wrong. It was not enough just to show up at a neighborhood clinic or a dilapidated frontline hospital if the system itself was unfair. I was the same doctor, on the same street, in the same city, and yet it was as if my patients and I had landed on another planet, one where, miraculously, they could live longer. And as my practice took me from hospital to hospital, from clinic to clinic, I discovered that the same embedded forces that created high-mortality neighborhoods also degraded the capabilities of the healthcare facilities that served them. These facilities were unequal, not because of the doctors or the nurses who practiced there, but because of the different resources they could draw on. I found that premature illness and death are spawned in communities of immense poverty and further exacerbated by the inability of healthcare institutions to provide complete care, as they are inundated by the uninsured. The tragic configuration of our fee-for-service system and the high rates of uninsured in the communities hardest hit by disease and death leave hospitals like County and Sinai in continual existential struggles. One street, two Americas. Along that 1-mile stretch of Ogden, there are two Americas of health and two Americas of healthcare delivery. One for those with insurance and money, and another for the poor, uninsured, and dispossessed. Along this centuries-old route through Chicago's West Side, my patients and I discovered everything that was wrong with health and healthcare in America, not just Chicago. The health inequities seen in microcosm there extend across the United States, in every major city, in Appalachia, on Native American reservations, and in many other places. While much of this book's focus is on the urban black experience, the structural violence that undergirds health inequality is a national problem. I came to realize this as I became a social epidemiologist. I began to study communities and social factors that lead to premature mortality and low life expectancies in Chicago. Black neighborhoods experience high degrees of hardship and have life expectancies closer to those in developing countries than in those in an advanced developed nation. What had been conveniently invisible became obscenely visible as I analyzed the data. I began to ask, how could such suffering and low life expectancies coexist alongside some of the finest healthcare systems and some of the wealthiest neighborhoods in the nation? Was this inevitable? How have public policies, laws, and real estate practices contributed to the multi-generational poverty and high death rates in certain communities? In many ways, my insights about premature death and the neighborhoods along Ogden Avenue follow directly in the footsteps of Friedrich Engels and Rudolf Virchow, both of whom wrote in the mid-1800s about social conditions and health. Engels wrote a seminal piece on the mortality of the working class in England, in which he equated the bodily injury and death that resulted from abject working conditions with manslaughter and murder. Virchow, the father of social medicine, wrote that a typhus outbreak in the Silesia region of Prussia had been caused by a lack of democracy in that region. The proper response to the epidemic was political, not medical. This book is written in the spirit of Engels and Virchow. It is aimed at the general reading public to provide understandable explanations for the state of health and premature death in the United States, with a focus on the social and political conditions that are at the root of inequity in life expectancy. Structural violence, the corrosive combination of poverty and racism, has killed millions of Americans over multiple generations in neighborhoods of concentrated poverty. These communities have been all but abandoned, while communities of concentrated wealth and advantage have thrived. This didn't have to be, and it doesn't have to stay this way. Disease and life expectancy gaps are not inevitable or immutable. This book presents practical policy and community-building solutions that can drastically reduce or eliminate these health inequities. With determination, we can chart a path forward to a healthier and more equitable society. Part 1. American Roulette. 1. American Roulette. Everyone knows that suffering exists. The question is how to define it. Given that each person's pain has a degree of reality for him or her that others can surely never approach, is widespread agreement on the subject possible? Almost all of us would agree that premature and painful illness, torture and rape constitute extreme suffering. Most would also agree that insidious assaults on dignity, such as institutionalized racism and sexism, also cause great and unjust injury. Paul Farmer, M.D. Windora has a stroke. The ear-splitting beep of my pager pierced the air. The message was from Megan, the nurse practitioner in my office. Windora Bradley is in the office, having a stroke. Stroke team activated. Come ASAP. I have been tethered to my beeper since my first day at Cook County Hospital in 1978. I still feel a jolt each time it squawks. My heart pounds. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. Then a hot flush of blood rushes to my temples as an adrenaline release, triggered by the electronic pulse, bombards my nerve endings. My nervous system had long ago hotwired my fight-or-flight reaction to the pager. It squawks, I react. I dropped what I was doing and jogged to the stairwell that leads to my office one floor below. It had been many years since I had to run to a medical emergency. My pace was slower and less graceful now, but no less determined. Windora was having a brain attack. As I skipped two by two down the stairs, thoughts of Windora and her illness flooded my own brain. Her tale had been a long one, though I hadn't thought it was leading us to this. Still, for the last year I had felt like a bystander at a three-alarm fire, as I witnessed her body self-combust. Windora is likely to die young because she is poor, because she is black, and because she lives in the wrong American neighborhood. She is just the latest victim of American roulette, a perverse game where the odds are stacked against the Windoras of the world. Russian roulette is a deadly game of chance. The gambler places a bullet in the chamber of a six-shooter gun. The chamber is twirled, he places the barrel to his temple, then squeezes the trigger. His fate is determined in an instant. American roulette is a lethal game that is played out over a lifetime in certain neighborhoods in America. How long you live depends on who you are and where you live. The early deaths that result from American roulette are not up to chance, though. The game is rigged. Live in my neighborhood, a diverse upper-middle-class community just beyond Chicago's West Side, and you can, on average, enjoy a long and healthy life. Live on Windora's block, and you will more than likely die an early death. Her medical problems were magnified by her neighborhood and life circumstances, and these are shaped as much by national forces as by local ones. Since 1975, inequality in income, wealth, and social well-being have risen in the United States, as public policies favoring the wealthy have been advanced at the expense of the poor. Tax, economic and criminal justice policies promoted by Presidents Nixon, Reagan, Bush, Clinton, and Bush too, reversed rules in place since the early 20th century and redistributed billions of dollars from the middle class and poor to the wealthy. The war on drugs and draconian sentencing laws led to the highest mass incarceration rates in the history of the world. Welfare reform, Wall Street deregulation, and global trade laws passed by Congress and signed by President Bill Clinton reversed the social contract between the government and the poor enforced since the Great Depression of the 1930s and the war on poverty in the 1960s. By 2005, the top 1% of Americans controlled more American wealth than the bottom 90%. One family alone, the Waltons of Walmart fame, is worth $145 billion, equal to the wealth of 43% of American families. The American dream has disappeared for millions of Americans like Wendora, who has slipped down the economic ladder over her lifetime. We speak of America as a democracy, but it has become a plutocracy, where members of a small minority dictate the shape of life and death in the nation through their grip on wealth. Because of their influence, the United States is vastly more unequal than other advanced industrial societies. And as inequality has increased, there has been a corresponding impact on life expectancy. Because life expectancies are so low in so many neighborhoods, the United States as a whole has dropped to the bottom of the world's developed countries in life expectancy. A doctor meets a patient. Wendora had been my patient for more than 30 years. We met in a small, steaming hot office in the general medicine clinic at the county hospital. She had full cheeks, with a wide ivory-toothed smile, mahogany eyes, and silky ebony skin. Wendora and I were both 27 years old then, and we had both moved to Chicago from elsewhere. But the chasm between us could not have been more stark. I was a middle, white-class man from New York State. Wendora had moved as a teen from Jim Crow, Birmingham, Alabama, to Chicago with her parents and 9 siblings. The Bradley family settled into the Cabrini-Green high-rise public housing complex on Chicago's north side, and then moved to a house a few miles to the west in the Humboldt Park neighborhood. By the time Wendora entered my office, her neighborhood had flipped from a mostly white and middle-class community into an all-black and Puerto Rican high-poverty, high-crime one. Meanwhile, I was living in a safe, mostly white and gentrified neighborhood less than 3 miles away. Still, we hit it off right away. What struck me the most, even in those early days, was her generosity and easy laugh in spite of her personal setbacks. Over time, as often happens in primary care practices, we became friends. We shared in each other's triumphs and tragedies. She comforted me when my father died, and I was the first person she called when her son had a cardiac arrest. Many of her family members became my patients, including 4 of her sisters and her son, daughter, and grandchildren. I became an unofficial member of the family. Wendora commanded a kitchen for the Chicago public school system, feeding elementary school kids for over 30 years. Her salary was barely a living wage, yet she raised 2 children in her family house. When I met her, she, like so many of my patients, was obese and had just developed diabetes and hypertension. And like so many of my patients, despite working a full-time job and having insurance, she often was forced to decide between feeding and clothing her children and buying her medicine. Tragedy and stress punctuated her entire life. Her mother and father died in their 50s from complications of diabetes. Her son died of cardiovascular disease at 42. Her granddaughter was murdered at the age of 8, one Easter Sunday in the alley near her house. The day before her grandnephew was to start his senior year of high school, he was shot and killed as he pushed a teenage girl out of the line of gunfire. These events, and the passage of time, took a devastating toll on Wendora's body. Her blood pressure and blood sugars fluctuated wildly despite powerful medications. She developed a blockage in one of the arteries in her leg, giving her knife-point calf cramps when she walked. Her heart raced out of control in paroxysms of chest-pounding flutters. Her skin mottled. I did what I could to manage her illnesses, but I was unable to slow the relentless course of her maladies. She was a runaway train of symptoms and disease. I was the hapless, helpless conductor. I was trained on the biomedical model of disease, which holds that diseases arise from biological defects or imbalances in the body. Our medical and surgical therapies are directed at treating these defects. In many cases, these approaches work. Vaccinations have all but eliminated childhood diseases that once killed by the millions. Antibiotics have cured diseases that were once a scourge. Modern therapies for hypertension and atherosclerosis have seen heart disease mortality plummet. New therapies have prolonged survival for many people with cancer. But despite these miracles of modern medicine, some American communities, like Windora's Humboldt Park, have death rates similar to those in developing countries. Why do these gaps exist? Structural violence. It is easy to look at Windora's brain attack through the lens of biology. Her diet, her lifestyle, and her innate biology all led to this moment when her brain is being suffocated by a blood clot in a cerebral artery. But what if it was not just biology that caused her stroke? There are many different kinds of violence. Some are obvious. Punches, attacks, gunshots, explosions. These are the kinds of interpersonal violence that we tend to hear about in the news. Other kinds of violence are intimate and emotional. But the deadliest and most thoroughgoing kind of violence is woven into the fabric of American society. It exists when some groups have more access to goods, resources, and opportunities than other groups, including health and life itself. This violence delivers specific blows against particular bodies in particular neighborhoods. This unequal advantage in violence is built into the very rules that govern our society. In the absence of this violence, large numbers of Americans would be able to live fuller and longer lives. This kind of violence is called structural violence, because it is embedded into the very laws, policies, and rules that govern day-to-day life. It is the cumulative impact of laws and social and economic policies and practices that renders some Americans less able to access resources and opportunities than others. This inequity of advantage is not a result of the individual's personal abilities, but is built into the systems that govern society. Often it is a product of racism, gender, and income inequality. The diseases and premature mortality that Windora and many of my patients experienced were, in the words of Dr. Paul Farmer, biological reflections of social fault lines. As a result of these fault lines, a disproportional burden of illness, suffering, and premature mortality falls on certain neighborhoods, like Windora's. Structural violence can overwhelm an individual's ability to live a free, unfettered, healthy life. As I ran to evaluate Windora, I knew that her stroke was caused in part by lifelong exposure to suffering, racism, and economic deprivation. Worse, the poverty of West Humboldt Park that contributed to her illness is directly and inextricably related to the massive concentration of wealth and power in other neighborhoods, just miles away, in Chicago's Gold Coast and suburbs. That concentration of wealth could not have occurred without laws, policies, and practices that favored some at the expense of others. Those laws, policies, and practices could not have passed or enforced if access to political and economic power had not been concentrated in the hands of a few. Yet these political and economic structures have become so firmly entrenched in habits, social relations, economic arrangements, institutional practices, law and policy, that they have become part of the matrix of American society. The rules that govern day-to-day life were written to benefit a small elite at the expense of people like Windora and her family. These rules and structures are powerful destructive forces. The same structures that render life predictable, secure, comfortable and pleasant for many, destroy the lives of others like Windora, through suffering, poverty, ill health, and violence. These structures are neither natural nor neutral. The results of structural violence can be very specific. In Windora's case, stroke precursors like chronic stress, poverty, and uncontrolled hypertension run rampant in neighborhoods like hers. Windora's illness was caused by neither her cultural traits nor the failure of her will. Her stroke was caused in part by inequity. She is one of the lucky ones, though, because even while structural violence ravages her neighborhood, it also abets the concentration of expensive stroke intervention services in certain wealthy teaching hospitals like mine. If I can get to her in time, we can still help her. Income inequality and life inequality. Of course, Windora is not the only person struggling on account of structural violence. Countless neighborhoods nationwide are suffering from it, and people are dying needlessly young as a result. The magnitude of this excess mortality is mind-boggling. In 2009, my friend, Dr. Steve Whitman, asked a simple question. How many extra black people died in Chicago each year just because they do not have the same health outcomes as white Chicagoans? When the Chicago Sun-Times got wind of his results, it ran them on the front page in bold white letters on a black background. Health care gap kills 3,200 black Chicagoans, and the gap is growing. The paper styled the headline to look like the declaration of war that it should have been. In fact, we did find ourselves at war not long ago, when almost 3,000 Americans were killed. That was September 11th, 2001. That tragedy propelled the country to war. Yet when it comes to the premature deaths of urban Americans, no disaster area has been declared. No federal troops have been called up. No acts of Congress have been passed. Yet this disaster is even worse. Those 3,200 black people were in Chicago alone in just one year. Nationwide each year, more than 60,000 black people die prematurely because of inequality. While blacks suffer the most from this, it is not just an issue of racism, though racism has been a unique and powerful transmitter of violence in America for over 400 years. Beyond racism, poverty and income inequality, perpetuated by exploitative market capitalism, are singular agents of transmission of disease and early death. As a result, there is a new and alarming pattern of declining life expectancy among white Americans as well. Deaths from drug overdoses in young white Americans, ages 25 to 34, have exploded to levels not seen since the AIDS epidemic. This generation is the first since the Vietnam War era to experience higher death rates than the prior generation. White Americans, ages 45 to 54, have experienced skyrocketing premature death rates as well, something not seen in any other developed nation. White men in some Appalachian towns live on average 20 years less than white men a half day's drive away in the suburbs of Washington, D.C. Men in McDowell County, West Virginia, can look forward to a life expectancy only slightly better than that of Haitians. But those statistics reflect averages, and every death from structural violence is a person. When these illnesses and deaths are occurring one at a time in neighborhoods that society has decided not to care about, neighborhoods populated by poor, black, or brown people, they seem easy to overlook, especially if you are among the fortunate few who are doing incredibly well. The tide of prosperity in America has lifted some boats while others have swamped. Paul Farmer, the physician anthropologist who founded Partners in Health, an international human rights agency, reflects on the juxtaposition of unprecedented bounty and untold penury. It stands to reason that as beneficiaries of growing inequality, we do not like to be reminded of misery, of squalor, and failure. Our popular culture provides us with no shortage of anesthesia. That people suffer and die prematurely because of inequality is wrong. It is wrong from an ethical perspective. It is wrong from a fairness perspective. and it is wrong because we have the means to fix it. Windora's last words. I pushed the swinging glass door to my office and hurried into the examination room to find Windora planted on a chair next to Megan. She gaped at me with a dazed, glassy-eyed stare. Sweat beaded and dripped in rivulets down her wrinkled brow. Windora, what's wrong? I asked.
Gah, gah, gah,
she gargled. Something terrible was happening. Check her sugar, I said to an assistant. Windora was a diabetic, and low blood sugar might cause something like this. Who dropped you off at the hospital? She struggled to find her words.
Dr. Ansell, she stuttered.
Do you mean Daryl? I asked. Daryl was her longtime companion. She stared at me blankly. There was fear in her gaze. The medical assistant quickly readied a lancet and stuck Windora's finger, drawing a drop of blood to check her sugar on a handheld meter. Doctor, it is 140, she said. That was high, not low. Megan had been right. Windora had been jolted by a massive stroke. One of the major blood vessels to her brain was blocked by a clot, and the flow of oxygen to the brain had slowed. The brain cannot tolerate being deprived of oxygen for very long, as the tissue supplied by the clotted artery begins to wither and liquefy, destroying brain cells. Windora's speech center was being strangled as we watched. Clinical trials have demonstrated that stroke damage can be reversed by a rapid injection of powerful clot-busting drugs. If that does not work, doctors can enter the occluded blood vessel through a catheter and attempt to extract the clot. But every minute that passes lowers the chance of success. The clock was ticking. It was fortuitous that Windora had the stroke right in front of us, and our office building was connected to the hospital. The stroke team was standing by in the emergency room. As paramedics whisked Windora away, we had good reasons to hope. In the emergency room, a team of doctors, nurses, and technicians began the complicated ballet of procedures required to reverse a stroke. They raced through the stroke checklist with NASCAR precision. Windora's strength had been normal in the clinic minutes before, but now her right arm and leg flopped by her side, paralyzed. The stroke was progressing rapidly. The team sedated Windora and placed her on a ventilator. A brain scan confirmed the diagnosis. The physicians injected the clot-busting medication into an intravenous line in her left forearm. For a moment, the room fell silent, other than the metronomic beeps of the heart monitor, as the team waited to see her response to the drug. A few weeks before, the ever-cheerful Windora had been in the office talking with Megan about her illness, her hopes, and her fears. The worst thing would be if I had a stroke where I still knew everything but could not speak, she had confided. Was this a premonition? Even in the best case, her worst fear seemed about to come true. Only 30% of patients with a cerebral artery blockage respond to clot-busting medication. Those who do can experience miraculous recoveries. Windora was not one of them. The stroke team members...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.